Good evening. It's a pleasure for me to present this webinar on behalf of the International Academy of Clinical Hematology, and I will talk about indication for allogeneic stem cell transplantation in acute myeloid leukemia. I am Arnon Nagler from the Hematology Division at Chaim Sheba Medical Center, Tel-Hashomer, Israel. So the learning objective of this webinar, again on behalf of the International Academy of Clinical Hematology, is whom should we transplant, whom should we not transplant, when should we transplant, how to choose the pre-transplantation preparative regimen, and how can we predict post-transplantation outcome. So we start with this picture, the morphology of acute myeloid leukemia. You can see the highly malignant, ugly cells. And some epidemiology, only 40% of patients with AML below the age of 60, which is good risk group because the median age of AML is about 10 years later, will survive more than 5 years. And also, even in the febrile risk leukemia, they have a mortality of 56% at 10 years. So AML is acquired disease of chromosomal translocation and somatic mutation with a single or multiple genetic events operating alone or together to produce the phenotype of differentiated block and proliferation at the myeloblast stage of hematopoiesis. AML is a heterogeneous group of malignancies characterized by the proliferation and accumulation of immature hematopoietic cells in the bone marrow. The leukemic cell replace and inhibit the growth and maturation of the normal hematopoietic precursors. And there is overlapping of transcription and signal transduction pathway, as well as growth factor receptor. And all of these lead to proliferation, survival advantage, impaired differentiation, and at the end of the day, unlimited self-renewal and the cancer, the malignancy, and the leukemia. So we have high genetic diversity with over 100 associated cytogenetic abnormalities, translocation and mutation, but we have only limited number of phenotypes. And recent effort based on the available new technique like next generation sequencing enable us to focus on studying the contribution of specific gen mutations to the pathogenetic of newly diagnosed refractory and relapse AML. Patients with AML have relatively few, perhaps 30 common recurrent genetic alteration. And some of these mutations, such as c-KIT, IDH1, IDH2, and FLT3, provide molecular therapeutic targets, and the FDA just approved in the last year and a half or so inhibitors to all these mutations. However, AML is rarely derived by one genetic event, and therefore targeting a single mutation is unlikely to lead to clinical cure. One of the theories of the developing of AML is the two-hit phenomenon, in which we have the first hit, which is giving advantage, proliferative advantage to the leukemic cells, and then we have the double hit, the second hit, which block differentiation. However, 40% of AML lacks mutation in gene encoding classical signal pathway, and therefore this theory cannot explain all the incidence of AML. The other theory is the leukemic stem cells. So we have self-renewal capacity that reside in a minority of leukemic cells. The phenotype of this stem cell is believed to be CD34 positive, CD38 negative. However, the transformation event may also occur in committed stem cell, and therefore this theory also cannot explain all the AML cases. So if we move now to transplantation, AML is the main indication for allogeneic transplant in Europe. And if you look on the pie, you can see that 38% of the allogeneic transplant in Europe are for AML. And this came out somehow, sum up to more than 9,000 transplantations for myeloid malignancies, as per a recent publication by Pazwek et al. That summarized transplantation in Europe in 2016. So the prognostic factor in AML are mainly today cytogenetic and molecular signature. There are the old prognostic factor, which are age, white blood cell at presentation, secondary origin, slow response to chemotherapy, and extramedullary disease. This risk factor account all also today, but we based today our treatment, as you will see, of AML and prognostication mainly by cytogenetic and molecular signature. Now, over the recent decades, as you can see here, we made some progress in the outcome of AML, but this progress is mainly the age of 15 to 59, because if you look here on the bottom, above the age of 60, and again, the median age of an AML patient is close to 70, you can see that the progress that we have made are really dismal. So the first prognosis of AML is by cytogenetics, and this is by a study by the M.Sc. in UK group, and you can see here that if you have the 15-17 translocation or the acute promyelocytic leukemia, the percent of patients that are alive are high, 81%. If we have the core binding factor AML, it's 61%, but if we have the very poor risk cytogenetic AML, which are inversion 3, complex karyotype, and monosomal karyotype, we can see that the prognosis is very bad. Now, if we look now on the official indication for allogeneic and autologous transplant for AML as per the EBMT, we can see here that transplantation is standard of care for AML intermediate risk in CR1, for AML high risk in CR1, and then for CR2, while in the other stages of the disease, we can see that this is optional. Now, this is based on this natural randomization of donor versus no donor studies. So the first one was published in Blood in 2007. This summarized four big studies, and you can see that in young patients below the age of 35 and with non-favorable or intermediate risk cytogenetic, there is advantage of the transplantation over no transplant. This is for disease-free survival, and this is also true for the overall survival. Again, up to in the young age group, relatively young, below the age of 35, in the non-favorable or intermediate cytogenetic, there is advantage of transplantation. And this was shown also a few years later by a similar study by John Corrett from Boston that now summarized 10 randomized studies. And you can see again that the transplant is beneficial, allogeneic transplant for intermediate and high-risk cytogenetic AML. What about the new era with the reduced intensity conditioning? So this is again from UK, the AML-15 study for patients above 45 that received as conditioning for transplantation reduced intensity conditioning. So it's based mainly on immunotherapy and not very high dose of chemotherapy or TBI. And you can see that for intermediate risk cytogenetic for sibling transplantation, there is advantage of the transplant. And this is the mature paper published by Russell et al. At Leukemia 2015. And you can see in this analysis by Mantel-Barr analysis of survival from CR by donor intermediate risk, you can see here the transplantation is beneficial only from sibling. In this case, it was not beneficial if it was unrelated donor. And if we do the analysis by time-dependent analysis of overall survival of reduced intensity allo transplant versus chemotherapy, we see that the transplant win again. So when we come to our patient and we need to decide, this is the flow chart, for instance, of the Hovon group. And we have here four points for a decision. First of all, we have to decide the AML risk group. And again, this is done today by molecular and cytogenetic markers. we need to define the quality of the remission, and this is done today by minimal residual disease, either by FACS or by molecular means. Then we have to evaluate the risk of transplant-related mortality. I will show you some work that we are doing at the Acute Leukemia Working Party for this issue, and then the prospect of relapse and after relapse. So if we look on the molecular classes of AML, according to this recent paper by Donner et al., one of the leading groups from Germany, we can see here the pie of chromosomal aberration in AML, but we can see that for each chromosomal aberration, we have a subdivision by molecular phenotyping, and this becomes very complicated. So if we look now on the driver mutation in AML, the frequency, with this seminal paper from Sloan Kettering by Papa Emmanuel, published in New England Journal of Medicine, we can see that the most prevalent mutation is the FLT3, to be followed by NPM1 and then DNM3A. And so the mutation dictates the prognosis of AML, but not just single mutation. We have to take into account the gene interaction, because if we take, for instance, FLT3, which is the prototype of bad mutation, we can see here that if you have FLT3, your overall survival is significantly lower than if you don't have the FLT3 mutation. But this is only if you are NPM1 mutated and DMN3A mutation. Because if you don't have, you have wild type NPM1 or DMN3, you can see that the FLT3, yes or no, make no difference. And this is also true for NRAS. So based on all of this, the European Leukemia Net came with prognostic certification of AML. We have the favorable risks that consist of T821, inversion 16, mutated NPM1 without FLT3 or with FLT3 low, and B allelic mutation CBP-alpha. We have then the intermediate risk AML with mutated NPM1 and FLT3 high, wild-type NPM1 without FLT3 or with a low FLT3 ratio, translocation 9-11, and cytogenetic abnormalities not classified as favorable or adverse. And then we have the very large group of adverse AML with translocation 6-9, EVA3, 9-21, minus 5, complex karyotype, monosomal karyotype, and then wild-type NPM1 and FLT3 high, mutated RUNX1, mutated ASXL1, and mutated TP53. But most importantly, or very importantly, is the minimal residual disease, because there is no wonder that if you have good karyotype, you have very good relapse-free survival. But this is only in the case that you are MRD negative. If you have good karyotype, and you are MRD positive, see how low is the curve for the relapse-free survival. Now, there are some mutations that can stay while you are in remission, and they make no major difference. So if we look on mutation at diagnosis in blue, and mutation in magenta at remission, we can see that NPM1 is very high at diagnosis and very low when you're in remission. The same is true for IDH2, but if, for instance, we look on DNM3A, we can see that this mutation remains while you're in remission. The same is partially true for TET2. And when in remission, this mutation, DNM3A and TET2, are also with a very high variable allelic frequency. And therefore, mutation for prognosis should not include the DTA mutation that stand for DNMA3, TET2, and ASXL1. The other mutation, if you are MRD positive, at any time you check, there is very high relapse, and if you are MRD negative, there is a low relapse rate. So now, if we combine all together, we can talk about or come to disease risk index that were developed by Professor Armand at Boston, Harvard. And we look with the aid of Professor Ronnie Shuval from our group on about 100,000 transplants in the EBMT registry You can see here the years, the age, the gender, of so on, the transplantation. And we wanted to know if the disease risk index predicts also in the EBMT data, the overall survival and disease and the event-free survival. And you can see that the disease risk index nicely discriminate between low, intermediate, high, and very high risk group of patients, dictating overall survival and event-free survival. Now that we have also to take into account the transplant-related mortality, so the day 100 mortality and overall mortality. This is extremely important when we consult our patient if to go or not to go to transplantation. And we again did it and published in JCO in 2015 by computerized intelligence on data mining. So the computer runs through 20 parameters that we decided that we all know the clinician, like type of disease, status of the disease, Karnofsky score, type of donor, CMV, and so on. And we came out with this data mining score that is in linear correlation with day 100 mortality. And we were able to divide this case, 350,000 transplants to a very nice 10 separate groups. So how we treat AML in according to the ALN guidelines, the European Leukemia Net, in 2017. So patients that are eligible for intensive chemotherapy get an induction therapy, the seventh so-called three, with 3 days of anthracycline, usually down or with seen at 60 milligram per meter square. You can give it also either rubicin instead or methoxantrone, and seven days of a continuous cytarabine or RAC at this dose. If you are young, have younger patients between the age of 18 to 60, and some other studies the age of 65, and the patient with febrile risk cytogenetic, you give the consolidation with high dose RAC. If you have intermediate risk genetic, then you usually go for allogeneic transplantation if the patient is fit. Alternatively, you can give the consolidation similar to what you give to patient in febrile risk, or give high dose therapy with autologous transplant. And for adverse risk cytogenetic, you need to go for allogeneic transplantation. If you have an older patient above the age of 60 or 65 in other study, then if it's febrile risk cytogenetic, you just reduce the dose of RAC. And if it's intermediate risk, there is no established value of intensive consolidation, so you consider allogeneic transplant in patients with low comorbidity score or data mining computer intelligence score, or you give investigational therapy. And for adverse cytogenetic, you should go for transplant if you can. If not, you are doing experimental therapy. So if we now look on the post-remission consolidation, and now in color, so again, in febrile risk cytogenetic, in age of 18 to 60, 65, you give the consolidation with high dose RAC. With intermediate risk, this is allogeneic transplant if the comorbidity is low, or a consolidation with RAC or autologous transplantation. And for adverse risk cytogenetic, you go for transplant. And for older patients, we will reduce the doses of high dose RAC for intermediate risk and go for transplantation if the patient is with low comorbidities. So the Spanish group, and this is courtesy of Professor Sierra, have similar therapeutic algorithm. They go up to the age of 70. They have the febrile risk group, intermediate risk group, or adverse risk group, with this definition by the molecular and cytogenetic. And again, for febrile group, we have the consolidation with high dose RAC. For the intermediate group, they can go to allogeneic transplant depending on the comorbidity score, or high dose RAC or autologous. And for the high risk group, no question, we need allogeneic transplantation. Now, whom should we not transplant? And this is based on this seminal paper by Schlenk et al. From Germany, published in New England Journal of Medicine. And you can see here that the patients are NPM1 positive without FLT3. Today we will add with low FLT3 ratio. then there was no advantage of donor. So this group of patients do not need transplantation. All the rest mostly need transplant, beside patients that have core binding factor AML without adverse features, patient with low MRD after chemotherapy, and patient with B-allelic core binding CBP alpha. If it's only monoallelic, this is not good prognostic factor. Now, even if it's a good prognostic mutation, if you are MRD positive, you're still doing bad. So if we take the NPM1, the best good prognostic mutation, you can see here that the patients that are MRD positive still have high relapse rate and lower leukemia-free survival. And this is also true for RUNX1 and CBP-alpha. So what about NPM1? Should we not transplant patients with NPM1? This is the dogma. But here we have the Journal Clinical Oncology paper published by a very big, prestigious German group. And they show that for patients with NPM1 mutated intermediate risk patient and from NPM1 mutated patient with no cytogenetic aberration and FLT3 wild type, that still if you have a donor, you do in the blue line, you do better for relapse-free survival, but this was not translated to overall survival. And so we at the EBMT, we first author is Professor Christopher Schmidt from Germany, published in Blood 2015, a paper in which we dissect 702 patients according to the makeup of NPM1 and FLT3, and showed again that the best result for leukemia-free survival and overall survival was the patients that were FLT3 negative, NPM1 positive, and we could come with a score that includes the FLT3 age above median and induction courses above one, and if you have neither of these poor prognostic factor, you are doing the best. So why transplant in bad mutation or bad prognostic disease? Not because of transplant is so great. You can see here the line in yellow, we can do much better. Because in every case, including the worst leukemia monosomal karyotype, transplant is better than non-transplant. And this was also shown recently for T53. So if you are T53 mutated, you're doing a transplantation worse than if you don't have the mutation. And this is also true for ASXL1. And the reason the transplant is helping in this poor risk cytogenetic, poor risk molecular AML is because the graft versus leukemia effects, the immunologic attack of the graft against the leukemia is with the same force, the same magnitude in AML with normal cytogenetic, so good risk or intermediate risk AML, as in patient with monokaryotype. So this monosomal karyotype, so this is the worst type of leukemia. So the immunological attack is the same, and this is why we go for allogeneic transplantation in this poor risk leukemia, although if you don't have this poor risk mutation, you are doing better. What about FLT3 ratio? So not just FLT3, but the ratio is very important. You can see here that if the ratio of the mutated FLT3 to the wild-type FLT3 is above 0.8, there is significant difference for overall survival and disease-free survival between patients that underwent transplantation to patients with chemotherapy. However, if the FLT ratio is below 0.8 and in the other studies below 0.5, then there is almost no difference, although advantage for transplantation, but not significant for overall survival, and the advantage for the leukemia-free survival is marginal. So in a more recent paper for the same point, if you have high ratio of FLT3, then transplant is much beneficial than non-transplant. But if you have low ratio FLT3, then in this case, no difference in overall survival between transplant and no transplantation. So the future should combine clinical data and the mutation phenotype of the leukemia. And so this is a very important paper published in Nature Genetics in 2017, again by the Sloan-Kettering group, in 1,540 patients. And by mathematic model, what they show that, for instance, in ALN favorable patient, a 29-year-old female with translocation A21, If you do the transplant in CR1 or postpone the transplant to first relapse, there is no major difference. However, in another patient with LN favorable, 49 years, male, normal karyotype, positive for NPM1, DNM3A, and IDH1. Here, if you postpone the transplant to relapse, you have a major difference, and indeed this patient relapsed after 1 and 2 years and died. So maybe in the future, like for the transplant-related mortality, we will need computerized program to help us. Why we are not deferring the transplant to second CR? Because many patients don't achieve second CR and don't get to the transplantation while they're in CR2. And also the results of transplantation in CR2 are usually worse than in CR1, and they are reasonable in favorable disease. But if you are intermediate or adverse risk disease, so the curves are not fantastic here. So what conditioning should we use? Again, we have a patient diagnosed with AML. We give him the 3-7 induction. If he's good risk, we don't do transplant. If he's high risk or he relapse, he should go for transplantation. If he is age below 55, we give the maximum conditioning or myeloablative conditioning. If he's above age of 65, we give non-myeloablative or reduced conditioning or less conditioning. And in the gray zone between 45 to 65, we believe today that the patient should get the maximal chemotherapy that he can hold, so myeloablative regimen, and if not possible, reduce intensity. For patients with persistent disease, we have today the sequential protocol in which, like flamzatine, but there are others, in which we give chemotherapy, and then 4 days later, we go for transplantation with reduced intensity conditioning. So MRD is also important for the result of allogeneic transplant in AML. And this recent paper in leukemia show that if you are CR and MRD negative, this is the best result. But most interesting for me is that if you have CR2 and MRD negative in the blue line, you are better than CR1 with MRD positive. So the MRD override the status of the leukemia, and as I showed you in the beginning, also override some of the impact of the mutation. And so we can do also MRD by next generation sequencing. I published this here a few months ago in Blood, and you can see here that the MRD status predicts the relapse rate, predicts relapse-free survival and overall survival, but not transplant-related mortality. And you can do it either with the peripheral blood or the bone marrow with the same effect. So after transplant, we still have relapse. And relapse is the major obstacle for successful transplantation. And this is 20 to 55%. And the main focus of the research today of transplantation in MLL is how to prevent relapse and how to treat relapse. So one way to prevent relapse in high-risk disease is by prophylactic DLI, as we published recently in British Journal of Hematology. So giving DLI without any evidence of disease. And you can see here that the high-risk group here, the overall survival is better significantly in patients that received DLI as compared to per-match analysis to those that did not receive DLI. Other way is azacitidine, epigenetic drug. This is paper by Charlie Craddock from the Acute Leukemia Working Party. And you can see that he came up with a score that if the relapse is with less than 20 blasts and more than 12 months from transplantation, you are doing better than if you have these risk factors. The anti-FLT3 are very important. This is the Alliance study, the first, the midostaurin that was given in induction during the consolidation and after transplantation, improving overall survival. And this is approved in the state and Europe, and we are using it. Other one is sorafenib, so is not so specific, but as you can see in this paper, it reduced substantially the relapse rate from 37.7% to 8.2%, resulting in improvement in disease-free survival and overall survival. And you can see here the reduction, significant reduction in the relapse rate and improvement of the overall survival. And this was confirmed by the group for Professor Motti from San Antoine in Paris in a recent cancer paper. There are many questions for the FLT inhibitors. You know, we need to check the true benefits. There was ongoing randomized trial. We need to see the tolerance. Patients are getting many drugs and sometimes there is side effects. We need to decide the optimal FLT inhibitor. Should it be highly selective or low selective? The gilteritinib was just approved by the FDA. We need the duration of prophylaxis. We need to know if combined to DLI. We have to decide if we give multiple kinase inhibition to non-FLT3. So many, many questions. And lastly, this paper that published by the Boston group with checkpoint inhibitor, ipilimumab, anti-CTLA-4, they treated relapsed post-transplant 28 patients, out of them AML, in 12 patients with AML, and four patients with extramedullary AML, and one that transformed from MDS, respond. And this is a patient with cutis AML that before treatment and after treatment, very impressive. Not all of this data could be replicated. So if I want to summarize this webinar, and we are getting to the end, genetic characterization of AML is essential and impact on treatment decision and prognosis. MRD are crucial. Allogeneic transplant is the most powerful anti-tumor treatment for AML, and genetic characterization of the disease and MRD provide useful information to decide transplantation in first CR. No allograft should be given in febrile genetic, as we discussed. Comorbidities are extremely important and we need to take them into account when we consult in patient to transplant. Allogeneic transplantation is mandatory in first CR in adverse cytogenetic. And in this case, we go for also alternative donors that we did not discuss today. And we have dismal outcome yet in the monosomal karyotype or P53 AML or the inversion 3, and we must do better. However, transplant is the best that we have because AML arises from a complex of set of molecular genetic events with competing clones for selective advantage, it is unlikely that we will ever treat AML with a single molecular targeting drug. Moreover, clonal evolution between diagnosis and relapse make it unlikely that those same molecularly targeted drugs that put the patient into remission at the time of diagnosis will produce a CR at time of relapse. And the key challenge will be to determine which are the most informative molecular markers that most reliably track leukemic population irrespective of the recognized clonal heterogeneity, rather than pre-leukemic clone, as I show you, that can persist in patient long-term remission like DMN3A, and our current ability to translate the recent knowledge of mutation landscape into clinical gain for our daily practice and patient is still far away. But the optimism on the future is really look better because we have a lot of new treatment for AML like protein, kinase inhibitors, some of them we talk, epigenetic modifier, cyclic or signaling inhibitors, monoclonal antibodies, myelotag, anti-CD3, that come back after was suspended by the after the Hovon trial, and new cytotoxic agent like the liposomal RSC dano, like the CPX-351. So there is still remarkable room for improvement. But we have a large number of drugs coming, 8 of them approved in the last year and a half after 20 years of no drug approved by the FDA for AML. Since AML is a rare disease, we need to collaborate, especially for the rare genetic subset, and cooperation is the key. So with this, I will finish. I thank you, and I am ready to take some questions. Yeah, I see the first question. The first question came on the screen. I mean, and it's read, what is the role of autologous transplantation? So I touch a little bit on it. Most of us believe in the graft versus leukemia effect and in the immunological attack of the GVL against the leukemia. But for low risk AML, there are studies, especially by Professor Goren and others, that show very good results also from the Hovon group for autologous transplantation. And some of the groups and centers in the world go in this good risk AML for autologous transplantation. Another question is about haploidentical transplant. So I didn't talk today a lot about haploidentical transplant, but haploidentical transplant revolutionized the scene in transplantation. The results in many studies, non-randomized studies, but in registry studies, both by the ECMDR and the EBMT, show no difference, and single center studies like from MD Anderson show no difference between haploidentical transplant and unrelated transplantation, 9 out of 10 or even 10 out of 10, and recently even for no difference from sibling transplantation. So I think a lot is happening with the haploidentical transplant, especially with post-transplantation sickle pioneered by Leo Luznik and Ephraim Fuchs, and the follow-up is still short and no two-arm studies, but it looks very promising. Another question is about cord blood transplantation. So yes, cord blood transplant, I didn't touch on it, is another alternative for transplantation and was recently shown that in MRD positive patient AML, a New England paper from Seattle show beneficial of cord blood transplantation compared to unrelated transplantation. And there are also new techniques for ex vivo expansion of cord blood, very nice results with engraftment a day 8 or 9 after infusion of the cord blood. Well, and of course, the question about CAR T cells and CAR T cell replacing transplant. Yes, CAR T cells is one of the most important things that happened in hematology, to my opinion, but this is still mainly with the CD19 lymphoma and ALL, with the two products approved for lymphoma and one for ALL up to the age of 24. We are a bit behind in acute myeloid leukemia, and I think that CAR T cells, I'm not sure that will replace, not today, transplantation, and we have to talk also in this case at AML, mainly also on allogeneic CAR T cells, for which you have to eliminate the T cell receptor from the T cells. So I think that we can stop now, because question can be for the next few days, and I'm willing to answer those questions if they come by emails or other means. And thank you again on behalf of the International Academy of Clinical Hematology, and good night. Thank you.